Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to this special broadcast episode of Pump It Out Radio for a conversation with Lieutenant Colonel Rick Francona. Lieutenant Colonel Rick Francona is a retired United States Air Force intelligence officer with 27 years service. He is an expert on the Middle East regions and can speak fluent Arabic. Rick has also served in the NSA, the DIA, as well as the CIA, and was selected to develop the Department of Defense Counterterrorism Intelligence Branch. Lieutenant Colonel Francona served in Gulf War I and led a special operations team supporting NATO forces in Bosnia. More recently, he has been a commentator and media military analyst for NBC News. Lieutenant Colonel Francona has also authored two books, including his 1999 book, Ally to Adversary, an eyewitness account of Iraq's fall from grace, and his most newly released book, Chasing Demons, My Hunt for War Criminals in Bosnia, which is available on Kindle. You can also find further analysis from Rick's Middle East perspective at francona.com and francona.blogspot.com.
Hi, Rick.
Yes, Jeff, can you hear me?
Hey, yeah, I can hear you fine. Thank you very much for letting me call you and talk to you.
Sure, no problem.
When we crossed paths the other day, I thought it was just somebody kind of pulling my leg or something about the clarification on the Arabic term. And then I punched your name into the computer, and I was like, I saw your website, and I was like, ooh, this guy would be pretty interesting to talk to. Like, I mean, reading about you, I mean, wow. It's like you've been everywhere. You've been in the military since, what, 1970, and you've been in the CIA, DIA, NSA. You started the DOD counterterrorism unit. I mean, you must know a lot. You must have experienced a lot too, I've been looking into this stuff for a long time. Like I said, 9/11 was the catalyst to kind of get me looking into this stuff. I looked into all the wrong stuff there for a while. But I've been fortunate enough in the past several years to be able to meet some good people and talk to people in the know like you. And that's what some of them, like one guy told me, I told you about the counterterrorism FBI agent. He said, if you really want to try and understand stuff, you need to be able to talk to people that are in the know. Don't just believe what you read on the internet. And a lot of the stuff on the internet's not true, as I've came to understand. You're an expert, obviously. You know how to speak Arabic. You've been everywhere. You've been to, what, Damascus. You've been to Saudi Arabia, probably Pakistan, Iraq. You were, obviously, I've seen that picture with you and Schwarzkopf.
I've never been to Pakistan. I've been to most of the Arab countries. Of course, when you speak Arabic, they tend to focus you on that. Of course, and I always kind of stayed in the Levant area, you know, Lebanon, Jordan, Syria, Saudi Arabia, and then in the Gulf because of the wars. A lot of time in Iraq, both in Saddam's Iraq and then working with the Iraqis, and then, of course, in Desert Storm trying to get rid of the Iraqis. But and then later on with CIA up in the north. It was an interesting career. Never did get over to Pakistan, although with the advent of Al-Qaeda and everything in Pakistan, you have to learn a lot about that part of the world anyway. Yeah, why don't you just go ahead and ask me what you're interested in, and I'll try and give you my thoughts.
Okay, well, from what I've learned, okay, it seems to me that, we got Hezbollah is a terrorist group, and we have Iran designated as a terrorist state, and we have all kinds of places designated as a terrorist state. How come Saudi Arabia is not designated a terrorist state? They were financing Al-Qaeda. I mean, you couldn't have had Al-Qaeda without the golden chain. You couldn't have had it seems like Saudi Arabia's biggest export besides oil is terrorism.
Terrorists, not terrorism.
Or terrorists, sorry, yeah.
Well, you've got many of the people involved in Al-Qaeda are Saudis. Of course, you've got Yemenis, North Africans. You know, it's a real hodgepodge of people from all over the Arabic-speaking world. But looking specifically at Saudi Arabia, of course, what, 15 of the 19 hijackers on 9/11 were Saudis? It's because Saudi Arabia tends to breed these people. it's the way the system is set up. You've got the monarchy there that allows no input, no political input from any of its citizens unless they're in the royal family or in that very favored few. So if you're a young Saudi and you've got the opportunity to go to Europe, the United States, get a really quality education, you go back to Saudi Arabia, your chances of landing a really good job or an influential position in the government are really slim, because all of the upper echelon of both the industry and the government are controlled by the royal family. So there's this real frustration bubbling below the surface there, where the Saudis don't feel that they have any input into their own lives, into their own political system. And it just breeds contempt for the government. And that's where al-Qaeda comes in. They come in and they recruit these guys, and they do a really effective job at it. You know, we always used to say that, you know, poverty and the lack of upward mobility was a real problem in the Middle East, and that's where you've had your recruiting grounds. But in Saudi Arabia, that's not always the case. These 15 Saudis that were in the 9/11 project were not destitute. Some of them were very smart people.
Well, yeah, that's what I was going to say. These guys weren't, like, at a loss for life or anything. These guys were really smart, and they had a great life ahead of them.
Exactly. If they had, if they believed that they lived in a country that allowed them to satisfy, you know, their political aspirations or to compete on a level playing field. So, you know, that's where Saudi Arabia falls down. Now, you look at what I don't think there's any real, and I've never been able to find the smoking gun where you've got actual Saudi government support for terrorism.
Well, that's what Bob Graham made it pretty clear, that those 28 pages that the Bush administration redacted involved the foreign financing of the terrorists coming from the Saudis, actually coming from Bandar's wife, going to the wife of one of the Saudi agents in San Diego that hooked, that kind of handled the two hijackers living with the FBI informant.
Okay, but what I think what we're seeing is, and I'm not making excuses for the Saudis, but I think what we're seeing is private Saudi money going to charitable organizations that are either fronts for al-Qaeda or they funnel the money to al-Qaeda. I have just never seen any Saudi government money going to al-Qaeda, because al-Qaeda wants to overthrow the Saudi government. That just doesn't make sense to me. And just a personal note, you know, I don't know. You're talking about Senator Graham, right? Bob Graham, the former.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. I don't know him. I've read some of his stuff. I just don't buy a lot of it, and I think he may be misinterpreting what he's reading in these intelligence reports. Because I just don't see the Saudi government covertly sponsoring al-Qaeda. It just doesn't make sense. Now, they sponsor a lot of organizations that I wouldn't send money to. A lot of them have to do with supporting organizations in the occupied territories, the different liberation groups, but I just don't see them supporting al-Qaeda. I don't think the smoking gun is there.
Like you said, through charities and stuff, like I got a book from a guy named Mark Silverberg where it's basically just a big list of all the different charities that are dubious. I guess
they don't have the watchdog organizations that we do. Like you could find out pretty much anything about an American charity.
But without like the golden chain, you couldn't have an al-Qaeda in a way, I guess, right?
Well, no. But, well, they're having, that's one of the problems with al-Qaeda right now, is they're running out of money. Because we've been pretty effective about cutting off their money. One of the things that CIA did a really good job was to break down the finances that support al-Qaeda. And then State Department and Treasury have been really good about going after that flow of money. I think that's one of our big success stories.
I don't know. It just seems like the head of the snake for terrorism would be lies in Saudi Arabia. Like, are you familiar with John O'Neill, the FBI counterterrorism expert there? He died on 9/11 trying to help people at the World Trade Center, and he said, everything we need to know, everything lies in Saudi Arabia to dismantle Osama bin Laden's al-Qaeda.
Back then, I don't think that's true anymore.
Yeah, back then. Yeah, exactly. Back then. Now it's a whole different story, right?
But, you know, look at what it could have gone way back. You go back to the USS Cole. I think that was a turning point in our understanding of Al Qaeda, and I think we missed the boat there. Now, O'Neill had a real problem with the U.S. ambassador in Yemen when they went over to investigate of what had happened to the USS Cole. Barbara Bodine was the ambassador, and I know her, and I think she's quite skilled as a diplomat. And she and O'Neill just did not hit it off very well. I think it's that there's always this, friction between law enforcement and intelligence and diplomacy. The three just never really seem to get along. And that's because they have different outlooks and different methods and different ways of dealing with foreigners. So I think that, O'Neill, I think he was onto something, but I think he had tunnel vision, and he didn't want to see anything else but what he believed.
And there's also that one famous instance where O'Neill and Louis Free went down to Saudi Arabia to investigate the Khobar Towers. Mm-hmm. And John O'Neill told Louis Free, the Saudis are blowing smoke up your butt.
Well, that's true. Every time we've had problems in Saudi Arabia and we go to the Saudis and we would ask them for access to people, be they terrorists or law enforcement or even small things, we could never get access to the actual people themselves. They said, no, tell us what you want, we'll ask them and all that. We even had, they even gave this a problem during the war in Desert Storm when they were taking thousands and thousands of Iraqi prisoners, and they said, well, we'll take care of the interrogations. You know, finally I said, no, you won't, because you don't know how to do it. I mean, you know, beating people up, beating confessions out of people is not intelligence. You're not doing this effectively. So we were able to get access to the high-value Iraqi prisoners. The Saudis did not want to do that. And they've stonewalled us for years. And the Khobar Towers investigation was a real travesty.
Yeah,
I think they were trying to cover any Saudi involvement there. That's why you will probably never find out what really happened in Pakistan with Osama bin Laden and how he was able to live that many years in a city housed Pakistani military academy, and the Pakistani intelligence service didn't know he was there. So they're either complicit or they're incompetent.
Oh yeah, exactly. And like the ISI, especially with foreigners, they know where they know who's who and where they are, kind of thing. I would imagine.
No, and the ISI is just absolutely riddled with these Pushtuns, and there is no way that Pushtun Wali, the code of the Pushtuns, is going to allow them to turn in Bin Laden to a bunch of Americans. That was just not going to happen.
And then there's like the thing with, now I know Saddam's a bad guy. I noticed you wrote a book on it. I'm going to get the book and read that book you wrote. But like in Bob Graham's book, he says we were seeing in writing what we suspected for some time. The White House was conducting the cover-up, and that has to do with the Saudis. But why did we attack Iraq instead of Saudi Arabia? I don't understand that.
When are we talking about? In 2003?
Yes.
Well, in 2003, the belief in the government was that the Iraqis had WMD and they were a threat to the West.
And that was based on forged Niger documents and curveball.
I don't buy it. Well, curveball was not. That was just a screw-up on the part of DIA. They didn't vet this guy. You know, anytime you have a walk-in, you have to be really careful. Because, and I've dealt with these people, they walk into the embassy, they say, I have secrets, and they're basically telling you what you want to hear. They know what we want to hear. So they said, I have secrets about Iraqi chemical weapons or the Iraqi nuclear program. And they know you're going to bite on that because that's one of our key intelligence objectives, to find that information out.
And like someone like Ahmed Chalabi would fall in the same category, tell you whatever you want.
Chalabi was... A different sort of animal. He was a political animal, and he was looking for power. He wanted to set himself up as the next president of Iraq, and he almost did. I worked with Chalabi in northern Iraq, and it was he's an interesting guy. He's smart, charming, brilliant, understands politics, but you know, I think he was willing to do whatever it took to get it done.
And people in the Pentagon, like Wolfowitz and those guys, and they it seems from what I've read and looked at, they wanted intel according to what they wanted to hear more than what the truth was. No?
I think that's probably human nature. People believe what they want to believe, and they say, well, this is good intelligence if it says what they want it to say. And they said, well, we're not sure about this if it doesn't fit into their preconceived notion.
And when it comes to the Niger documents, like, we all know that those were forgeries. But how come no one's ever bothered to find out who forged the documents?
I think you're accepting fact where maybe there aren't. I don't know that we know documents were forged. It depends on who you listen to.
Well, like Butler, the FBI agent, he told me, like, he said, Jeff, if I had all the resources in the world, I'd want to find out who forged those documents. And till this day, I can't find out. I talked to the lady who was handed the documents by Rocco Martino, and she's, till this day, still scared to tell what she knows.
I'm not real familiar with the background and all of that, but I think the British still stand by their original reporting. It wouldn't surprise me that Saddam was trying to buy yellow cake. That's no big deal.
And then the whole situation with Joe Wilson and everything, like...
Yeah, I knew Wilson when he was the deputy chief of mission in Baghdad. I was at the embassy there when he was there, and he was a pretty good officer. But I'm not buying all this stuff with his wife. I think there's a lot more to the Valerie Plame, Joe Wilson thing than meets the eye. And, of course, when all that happened, I had already retired, so I didn't really have any access to what they were doing.
And what about, like, how they say, was there communication between the FBI and the CIA? You know how they say, oh, there's the wall?
Well, there was a wall, and I'm told from my contacts that it still exists. This is a Department of Justice fabrication, this wall. They have this line, this wall between law enforcement investigation and intelligence information. And here's the problem. When you're collecting intelligence and you've got something that might be actionable that also has law enforcement implications, so you find out an American citizen is involved in some nefarious activity, terrorism, smuggling, selling... end-user items to countries that aren't supposed to have it, that sort of thing. And you discover this information overseas through your intelligence work. Well, when you're required, of course, to provide that to the FBI. Well, once the FBI gets it, they say, okay, thank you, and they take all that information and they mark it as evidence. And once they mark it as evidence, you can't use it.
Well, yeah. Well, I guess when you were involved in the CIA, you were... Scheuer would have been the head of the UBL unit, I guess, Alex Station?
Yes.
They were, the NSA and the CIA were monitoring the Yemen communications hub since 1998 or something. They were getting every incoming, outgoing phone call, etc. But this was after your time and after Scheuer's time with the UBL unit, where they purposely withheld information about al-Nidar and al-Hamzi coming to America.
I don't know that they purposely withheld. See, I don't know how the reporting chain went. Most of the time, these things, you know, when they say things were withheld, I think they probably mean it wasn't reported. Not that somebody made a conscious decision not to report something.
Oh, well, it's been proven. Like, Doug Miller and the FBI tried to draft a cable about Midar and Hamzy, and then somebody in the UBL unit stopped them from sending the cable, and then they sent out a cable later that day saying that the FBI was informed. And even Richard Clark says, till this day, I do not know why the CIA would withhold such crucial information from us.
Well, I don't believe almost anything that Richard Clark says.
Oh no. Well, that's what a lot of people are the same. I've heard that a lot. But.
A low life. I have no use for Richard Clark.
But wasn't like when Sandy Berger was going and stuffing those papers into his pants? Wasn't he trying to get rid of the terrorism assessment that Clark put out?
That is a really good question that I wish I knew the answer to. What document was he trying to get rid of?
Because he thought that it would fall on his head or something.
Yeah, I think he was trying to hide some sort of information that the White House must have known. I don't know. There's just so many unknowns and all that.
Well, what about, have you ever crossed paths with a guy named Richard Blee, who was the head of the UBL unit after Scheuer?
No, when I retired, Scheuer was still there.
Oh, he was, yeah.
In fact, I had two people in the UBL unit that we sent two of our officers over there to work inside of that, because we both knew that we worked together would probably be better. So I had two of my officers assigned to Scheuer's outfit, and it was productive. I don't know. Scheuer and I didn't get along.
Yeah, there's a lot of mixed feelings about Scheuer. I don't know. I can't say I don't know. I don't know.
I was at when I was at NBC News, he would sometimes be on the air with me, and I think we got along fine. Yeah.
When I was reading through your website, I came across one article there that was really confusing to me, and it was your article where you were talking about Bandar and how he was like all depressed and all that stuff.
That was right after the Iraqis invaded Kuwait. My boss and I went over to his house there in McLean and gave him a big briefing and all that. Yeah, he knew his country was going to war.
Yeah. So he's not like, do you think he's getting a bad rap or more than
Bandar? I like Bandar. Yeah, I think he was a very effective ambassador for his country.
Because, you know, the whole BAE scandal and everything, the Aluyama, et cetera, where it's kind of funny that Louis Free ended up being his lawyer. I was reading where it said, like, Prince, in The Guardian, it says here, Prince Bandar, the head of Saudi National Security and son of the Crown Prince, was allegedly in court to be the man behind the threats to hold back information about suicide bombers and terrorists. He faces accusations he himself took more than $1 billion in secret payments from the arms company.
When was that written?
February 15th, 2008. He basically makes it sound like he had he was using Al-Qaeda as his attack dogs.
This is Bandar bin Sultan?
Yeah.
I'd have to read that.
I don't know. Like, I just, every thing I came across with Bandar, it's like he's always, he doesn't look good. And, like, he was waiting for the bombs to drop in Iraq in the second war. I don't know. Like, I'm just asking questions, and I hope I don't offend you in any way. Like, I love America, and I don't want to see it. I don't know. I guess in my head I think it's going to – we're looking at the end of America because of all these problems that we're having if we don't, like, fix them or something. But
oh.
I don't know. I heard that those satellite images that you guys were on your hands and knees looking at were fake satellite images, where Cheney was trying to get Bandar to think that Saddam was lining up, getting ready to invade. Like, have you ever heard that rumor before or whatever, or is that...
No, I don't think they were fake. It'd be very hard to fake something like that.
I mean, yeah?
These conspiracy theories where Darth Vader, Cheney was pulling all these strings and doing all that, there's just too many people involved in the intelligence community for that to happen. Now, that doesn't mean the intelligence community doesn't make mistakes, but I mean, cover-ups are very, very hard to do because everybody has to be on board, and we're not real good at keeping secrets, as you.
Well, yeah, I've always heard that we're not good at keeping secrets. Like, Washington's not really very good at keeping secrets, but. As far as, like, the 28 classified pages in the Joint Intelligence Committee, do you think those should be released to the public by now? It's been, like, over 10 years. Would you think that's okay? Or?
On what subject specifically?
The foreign financing of al-Qaeda?
Probably not, because those sources, we're probably still using those sources.
Yeah.
It's not so much the information. This was always, I learned this from a very smart guy at the Pentagon one time. He says, you know, most of the time the information we have, the intelligence information, isn't that sensitive. It's how we developed it. You know, which network we may have been listening to, or what person we've had to recruit to get access to the information. It's not so much the information itself. It's the person or the system through which we gained it.
I think it was Schaefer that said one time, like, intelligence isn't really information. It's going through that information and coming to conclusions based on logical reasoning or something, which is the intelligence. It's not just a whole bunch of information.
That's supposed to be the value added. You know, you take raw intelligence information, you're supposed to, and the key that, like, you know, and I've had this conversation with news people when I was at NBC. They said, well, we do like you do, and we gather information and we report it. I said, no, no. What the intelligence community does is they gather information and they send it to, and it goes through another step. It goes through an analytical process where that information is evaluated, weighed, corroborated, and an assessment made on whether it's valid or whether it's not, or whether it's maybe it's an aberration. The news people just take the information and report it. You know, the we report, you decide phenomenon. So yeah, Tony's right. I mean, it's and you see this at the top of every intelligence report. This is not finally evaluated intelligence. This is raw intelligence information. So there's a difference. Yeah, he's right. So how do you know Tony?
I just met him through the internet. Just like I met you. But I really appreciated, like, you know, I got his book, Operation Dark Heart, and his information just adds to the whole thing, where he identified three of the terrorist cells before 9/11, and then he was shut down, and then they tried to smear him, and they were stealing pens and stuff or whatever.
I really am still confused about all of that, because I know, just like you, you read all this stuff, and you say, who do you believe?
Truth is the first casualty of war, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah.
But, like, what do you see happening over in the Middle East? I mean, with all this stuff going on, it seems like maybe we're just indirectly, by accident, it seems like we're making a lot of the wrong decisions. Like, I mean, it seems to be that we're fomenting more terrorism and we're enabling Islamic, radical Islam to take over in the Middle East, where we're really going to have a big problem with it, the way things are going. Like,
well, look, let's just start with, you know, with Iran. Okay, we have pretty much handed Iran the regional power that they've always wanted, because of the absolute lousy execution of the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. If those had been executed properly, we wouldn't be having a problem with Iran. So now Iran is on the rise. If Iran gets a nuclear weapon, I think that's going to set off an arms race in the Middle East. I think the Saudis are going to say, well, we want it. Well, they won't develop one. They'll buy one. The Turks will look at this and say maybe they need to get in there as well. The Egyptians, certainly. And then if you look at what they were calling the Arab Spring, you know, all the changes in all these Arab governments, that still remains how that's going to shake out. But look at the rise of the Islamists in all of these countries. I mean, even Turkey has an Islamist government now. We don't know what's going to happen in Egypt, because I think, if you read my last piece, I think the military pretty much has just handed the election to Amr Moussa.
Yeah, I read your last piece where you did a little description on each of the candidates, et cetera.
Yeah. I think that's probably going to work out okay.
Like, what's the main goal of Islam? Isn't it to form some caliphate and engulf the whole world under Sharia law? Like, I mean, I can't get a straight answer from anybody. I try to talk about it to different people who say they're followers of Islam, but everything I say that has anything negative, they say, oh, that's corrupt hadith, or that's perverted Islam. It's like, well, where are these guys getting the idea to go blow themselves up?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you just hit the nail on the head. It's how you read the Quran, but for them to come up and say it's a religion of peace and love and tolerance, it's just not there. I mean, don't look at what they write. Look at what they do.
Well, that's the thing. I you know, you can say one thing and do another. And
well, listen to the Egyptian Islamist candidates, what they're talking about. They want to abrogate the peace treaty with Israel. They want to break diplomatic relations with Israel. Why? Because they're Jewish.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. When I was talking to one guy, he's like, the bankers are the problem. But really, he's saying the Jews. Like, they're blaming everything on the Jews, kind of, you know?
Well, they have to blame somebody.
I don't know. I don't want to see... Like, Scheuer, I corresponded with him through email, and he seems to think that we're going to have a bigger problem here in North America soon than they do over in Britain and stuff with radical Islam.
I don't know. I think Muslims right now are, what, 3% of the population here? Might be slightly higher in Canada.
And then, like, I see these documentaries where they got these little kids bobbing their heads back and forth, memorizing the Quran, and it's like these madrasas and these mosques, they're like staging grounds for terrorism.
They are indoctrination centers.
Yeah.
And of course, this has always been the goal of a propagandist, is you get children while they're young. And, you know, look how you were probably brought up in one particular belief system, and you got that from your parents or from your teachers.
Right, right.
All of that was instilled in you when you were very young, and that's what they're doing, and it's very effective.
But is there any other, what's the best way you think we could try and stop this?
Well, I'm hoping that the way North American is, you know, the Canadian-American governments are structured and our society is structured, is that we tend to assimilate people much better than the Europeans. When people move to, any people, when let's say the Bosnians move to Germany, when the Turks move to Germany, when the Volksdeutsch move back to Germany, they live in enclaves. And they don't really assimilate. Look at the Moroccans and the Algerians when they moved to France. They set up themselves in these barrios, in these ghettos in Paris. And these are almost no-go zones for the French police because they maintain that separate identity for generations. In the United States, if you look at, say, the Hispanic influx into the United States, in two generations, these people are speaking English and are Americans. They're totally assimilated. The only thing they have Hispanic is their last name.
Yeah, I could see that. But, I mean, even here, like in Canada, we had a famous trial where, you know, the husband killed his daughters because they were becoming too North Americanized. You know, they were going to the mall and wearing jeans and wearing makeup and stuff. And it's like,
we have those honor killings here, but we're not buying the Sharia argument yet. So
you think you don't think that we should be?
Oh, I think we should be concerned, but I don't think there's. I don't see it as a crisis.
Should we maybe start looking at Saudi Arabia in a different way?
Oh, I've always said we should be looking at Saudi Arabia in a different way. We need to convince the Saudis to change. Now, you know, I don't advocate, you know, overthrowing the royal family, and there's a lot of people that do. But I think we should be working with the Saudis. And trying to convince them to open up their government and their businesses to more of the Saudi people. Because by the current system of corruption and patronage that runs the country, they're just creating all this animosity that feeds into the desire for change. And if they don't watch what they're doing, they're going to become Iran of 1978-79. Or Egypt of 2011.
I was watching a debate with Joe Wilson and Bill Kristol, and Joe Wilson finally got Kristol to say why we went to Iraq. And Kristol said, we went to Iraq to change the dynamics of the Middle East. What do you have any perspective on what he meant by that?
Well, I don't. I don't know what he meant. I think he said we wanted to get rid of. I think I would take that to mean he wanted to start removing these dictators and force some changes of government and hopefully get more representative governments in power. I mean, if you look at all of the Arab countries, none of them were true representative governments. You know, so they were trying to get rid of these, some of these strong men. I mean, look, you know, Iraq, Egypt, Syria. I mean, Lebanon was probably the, one of the closer ones you'd come to, but that's just a basket case. And
what about the troops? Like, do you think it's time we should bring them home and kind of figure out what should we do? This is not a good thing. All we're doing is we're physically injuring our troops and we're mentally injuring our troops.
You talking about Afghanistan?
Yeah.
I think our mission there was done a long time ago. The goal of what we went to do was to remove the Taliban because they were providing a safe haven for al-Qaeda. We took down the Taliban. We destroyed most of al-Qaeda, pushed them out. Most of them went to Pakistan, and then they went from there to other places. They went to Iraq. Then they moved to Saudi Arabia, and then they're moving to Yemen. Now you see them springing up in places in Africa. But they're not in Afghanistan. And as long as al-Qaeda is not in Afghanistan, I don't know why we are. We are absolutely lousy at nation building, so we shouldn't be doing it.
Should our intelligence apparatuses be trusting the ISI or the GID?
No. In Saudi Arabia, I've never trusted the GID, but they're actually pretty effective at internal security. They're not real good at foreign intelligence. They never have been. And when we worked with them during Desert Shield, Desert Storm, that became readily apparent. They are excellent at internal security, finding out what's going on inside the kingdom. So when they decided they were going to go after al-Qaeda, they were very effective.
Because I saw an interesting clip on CNN from Bandar where he said, we were tracking most of the hijackers with precision. So they were tracking them.
No, they were tracking them when they were in Saudi Arabia, but after they left, and many of them went, they went overseas before they did anything. But the ISI, I believe, is a corrupt organization that almost operates outside the bounds of the Pakistani government and certainly is not acting in our interest. I wouldn't. If you look at here, give you an example. The drone strikes that we were doing in Pakistan,
mm-hmm.
and we said we're hitting Taliban and al-Qaeda leadership, and that's true. But we were only hitting the al-Qaeda and Pakistani Taliban leadership that the Pakistanis wanted us to. We didn't do any unilaterally targeting over there. It was always in conjunction with the ISI. So we were whacking the guys that they didn't like and not whacking the guys that they did like, regardless of their affiliation.
Like some I was talking to some sheikh guy, and he had told me to look into Lawrence of Arabia. I could learn a lot from that. It seems that Lawrence of Arabia was basically saying, get out of there and let them work it out themselves or something.
I don't know. After the war, he was really, after World War One, he tried to establish Faisal in particular in leadership roles, and I think he was very upset that the British didn't give more autonomy to these leaders. I'm trying to think of the book. There's a good one written by Lowell Thomas called With Lawrence in Arabia. I think it came out in like 23. It came out after the war, but that's a good book. Still available.
Oh yeah, I'll have to check that out. What about how we've just the intelligence apparatus that we have now? Do you think we're better off with it? Like all these people saying, we're losing all our freedoms and they want to spy on us and take away all our privacy. Like personally, I would love the CIA or anybody in the intelligence to be able to look into my email or anything. Maybe they could learn something. Because I talk to a lot of people like you and stuff like that, and I have, like, other people. I have this guy who's ex-military intelligence. He's really smart, and he's helped me out a lot. I mean, why? They're not relying on human intel anymore. What are they relying on these days?
Well, that's always been a problem. We tend not to use human effectively, and we over-rely on the technical systems. I like the way our laws are set up, that the intelligence community operates overseas, but when they do operate inside the United States, they have to do it with FBI participation and with warrants. I don't have a problem with the intelligence community conducting domestic operations as long as it's under the supervision of a judge. I am really very concerned about any kind of domestic spying without some sort of legal basis. Overseas, hey, you know, that's what they do. But I am concerned about that. I don't like the structure that we've adopted with our intelligence agencies. I think that the way they tried to structure it, the DNI, the Director of National Intelligence, they created that new position. They created a new position, but they didn't give them any authorities. So really, the Director of CIA still has too much power.
Well, yeah, like George Tenet, I don't know. Do you think he deserves the Medal of Freedom?
No, not really. Have you read his book?
No, I didn't bother to read that one.
Yeah, and don't. no, it was a big. Nothing was my fault, and I'm the real hero here. No, it was. I don't think he does. A lot of people. I don't think he deserved it. Who else in that batch? And Jerry Bremer certainly did not deserve it. Jerry Bremer was the cause of most of the problems we are living with in Iraq today.
Oh yeah.
He went over there and disbanded the Iraqi army. That was the beginning of the insurgency. That was the stupidest thing we ever did in Iraq. Stroke of a pen.
So every little mistake we make can turn into big problems.
Oh well, I mean that was I think the key mistake. If we could go back and undo that and get out of there on a reasonable timetable and turn it over to the Iraqis like we were supposed to. I mean, the plan was brilliant. The plan was to go in there, and the plan worked up until the fall of Baghdad. That was great. And then, for whatever reason, we decided we had to go into nation building again, when the idea was to turn it back over to the Iraqis. You know, we had recruited so many Iraqi generals prior to the war. We knew which ones were not going to fight, and we knew which ones we could trust. And when it was all over, we were going to hand Iraq over to them and say, okay, over to you guys. You figure it out.
Yeah, like it seems like Bush 1 did a decent job in Kuwait.
Absolutely.
Where we just went in there, we did what we did, and we left.
Exactly, and that's what we should have done. Gone over there, got rid of Saddam, because I agree with the assessment by 19. In fact, I think we knew this in 95, 96 when I was running around the north with the Kurds. There was not enough internal opposition to overthrow Saddam. It was going to require some sort of external assistance. I think we are rapidly approaching that position, if we're not already there, in Iran. I don't think there's enough internal opposition inside Iran anymore. I think they've been very effective in weeding it out. So look at Syria. All they're going to do over there is have a bloody civil war, but neither side's going to win right now.
I heard you talking where it was like there's so many different factions joining together to fight against Assad, but, you know, once Assad's gone, what's going to happen with all these different factions?
Well, there's also a lot of factions supporting Assad. You know, the Christians, the 300 Jews that are left, and many of the Sunnis are backing him because they fear more than Assad, they fear the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood. Whether that's valid or not, I don't know, but that's what's happening.
Yeah, it seems everywhere that gets toppled, it ends up being some kind of extremist takeover sooner or later. We had a hand on all these places through these proxy dictators in a way, which was not good, but it had its good points because at least we knew, like say for Saddam didn't like radical Islam or any of that. But with him gone now, it seems like they're going to take over Iraq, like they did with in Kuwait, where I just seen an article that says Kuwaiti MPs want to kill anybody that curses God now and stuff. And
yeah, well, let's go back to Iraq. I don't think, depending on how you're defining the radical Islamists, I think Iraq is going to be Shia-dominated for years and years to come. And I think that that's going to be just basically an Iranian puppet government, if it isn't already. I think it is already. El-Nouri is nothing more than a mouthpiece for what he's told by the Iranians. You've got Sunnis that don't like it, but they're the weakest of all now, and the Kurds just want to be left alone. So I don't really see Iraq becoming a Sunni fundamentalist state. I think it will become more of a Shia puppet to Iran.
Like I said, it's so confusing, and it's really hard to try and figure this stuff out, especially when it's like so foreign to someone like me. You know, I guess someone like you, it would be a big help to be able to speak and understand the language and stuff. But
it's almost overwhelming when you look at it. You know what's going on. I mean, there's so many things going on in so many different places. It's like it's almost out of control.
And then, like, I can't understand what they're saying in videos, but you can go to YouTube and see all, like, when they have, like, the protests and stuff, and they're calling, like, you see the black banners being waved, right? The black banners with the white writing is, like, the Al-Qaeda flags. Like, the title of Ali Soufan's book, The Black Banners. In a way, we're indirectly helping these radicals, it seems.
Yeah. Well, we've done a lot of things that would play right into their hands. Yeah. Staying in Iraq all that time, all that did was bring Al Qaeda from Pakistan to Iraq, and created an insurgency that didn't have to be. But so that's what are you gonna do? That's in the past.
Well, would you be interested if I sent you some information if you might be interested to look at, and I can just get your take on stuff I've been looking at?
Yeah, do you have my email?
Well, I could just I can send you a message and get you get your email and then send it. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me. And like I said, hopefully maybe one day we can talk again sometime about things.
Sure, just let me know. I'll be I'm usually here. So.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Rick. I really do appreciate it, and I'll keep in touch with you.
Okay, take care.
Okay, you too. Bye bye.
Bye.
Thank you very much for listening, everybody. I hope you were able to gain some knowledge from my conversation with Lieutenant Colonel Rick Francona. For further information, you can go to Rick's websites, francona.com and francona.blogspot.com, as well as read his books, Ally to Adversary, an eyewitness account of Iraq's fall from grace, and the newly released book, Chasing Demons, My Hunt for War Criminals in Bosnia. Until next time, take care.